Sorry for the inconvenience. Professor Rahul N will be joining with us very shortly.
Hello, everyone. Good afternoon, one and all. Our second session for this for the seminar is about to start. I request Dr. Susan Thomas to introduce the speaker to us.
Good afternoon, everyone. My colleagues in the department, paper presenters, our chief guest presenter of the day, Dr. Susan George, other research scholars, welcome to the second session of our international webinar on mediated realities. It gives me great pleasure to introduce the session to you, Dr. Susan George. Dr. Susan George is at Jesus and Mary College, University of Delhi. She completed her master's from St. Stephen's College, Delhi, and also her MPhil and her PhD from University of Delhi. Sorry, her PhD from IIT Delhi. The title of her thesis is very interesting. It reads Music Record to Internet, Studying the Temporality of Music Video. I'm astounded by the amount of interdisciplinary work that she has done. Her paper presentations have a wide range of titles, starting from women in film time, watching Game of Thrones in India, Anglo-Irish identity in Mary Edgeworth's fiction, a wide range of topics she has researched and has talked upon in various invited talks as panel member. We are extremely privileged to have you, ma'am, with us in this. And I understand Dr. Susan George is an expert on film and new media specific. It's our privilege to listen to and on such an interesting topic like social media. It needs no introduction. The topic needs no introduction. Social media has been both glorified and tarnished at the same time during this pandemic age. And I happen to read somewhere that the first wave of pandemic has increased the social media engagement by almost about 61%. For many people, it's a lifeline to remain connected to the outside world. For the younger generation, perhaps it's the only source of entertainment. And for us who look at it from, to quote the title of our webinar, from this looking glass, have both positive and negative, perhaps, ideas to say about or to discuss about the social media, especially about mishaps, which Dr. Susan George will be talking about, the impact of misinformation and other ways of in which social media, YouTube and Instagram have been source of anxiety and stress for the pandemic during the pandemic times. I wouldn't elaborate further on this issue because Dr. Susan George is definitely going to give us a very interesting session. So thank you so much, ma'am, for accepting our invitation and coming over to this webinar. And it's over to you. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Thomas, for the introduction. And thanks for having me. I'm very, very privileged to be here at your conference. I managed to catch a little bit of the morning session as well. And overall, just all the talks that you have lined up, I think, are fascinating. And I hope that I can contribute in some little way to the discussions that are going on. So as Dr. Thomas said, I will be discussing social media at some length, but I must warn you that so my talk is a little conceptual, which I believe is a good thing. I must first thank actually Dr. Ashley for inviting me, Dr. Ashley Phillip, who got in touch with me. So most of my work on new media has been routed through studies of the video, as you would have heard from the title of my doctoral work. So I'm actually going to be looking at the video form as we consume it today on social media. Okay. So to introduce, I mean, in a very generic manner, my talk, and I'm using a few slides, but believe me when I say they're purely indicative, and perhaps not in the correct order as well, but I hope that I'll be able to follow a certain order of my logic. So when I'm going to be talking today about social media, I'm going to be looking largely at the video form as it's consumed by most of us via social media platforms like YouTube and WhatsApp, and as Dr. Thomas mentioned, Instagram, right? And my thesis, you know, I guess my point of entry, my summary point, is to look at how human memory and memory cultures, as we understand them, develop transductively with memory technology. Now, transductivity is, of course, a term that we borrow from machine learning and AI. The idea is that, you know, we built the machine, but what came first, the machine or us? And we kind of actually, our memory cultures are, I will argue, and therefore our consciousness and our understanding of ourselves, developing, or, you know, along with and in parallel with our use and consumption of memory technology, or what theorists call hyponemata, right? So when I look at this, I will be accessing it, like I said, through video culture, using social media and YouTube to analyze how the program industry, and this is the term that Bernard Stiegler uses to replace Adorno's culture industry, right? So I'll be looking at how the program industry constructs, re-territorializes, and archives collective memory and what that does to human consciousness, right? But to start first, you know, before I plunge into this, now memory for me, in my understanding, is linked to time and temporality and our understanding through our consciousness of the movement of time. So one of the very important sort of cornerstones of understanding, you know, what I'm going to discuss is also how human consciousness and time operate. Now, most of us, and I know that this is a PG department, so you're all extremely erudite students and scholars. So most of us understand, you know, that there is a lot of underpinning of, you know, studies of memory and time at turn of the century philosophy and early 20th century philosophy. I have, for my work, especially been using, you know, the models of temporality as put forward by philosophers such as Edmund Husserl and, of course, Martin Heidegger, right? Heidegger especially because he's someone affiliated with discussions of technology and machines. Now, Husserl, you know, described the functions of, you know, human consciousness and our perception of temporality, of time, through a process of, you know, a creation of retentions, right? The simple way in which he illustrated it, of course, was using music. And I think that's perfect because it leads to our discussion of media. You know, Husserl said that, you know, when you're experiencing a melody, when you experience a note of the melody in the present, of course, you perceive that note not just as an independent note in the melody, but you enjoy it through a kind of collapsed perception of that note, what preceded it and what you will expect after. So there is what Husserl called retentions and pretensions. You know, I have memorized, even if the first time I hear a piece, I memorize the melody. And with each passing note, and passing is important, you know, with each passing note, I also have a sense of expectation of what is to come, the futural possibilities of that melody. So this is, you know, this folded structure of temporality. I think this is very important for our understanding of how we are never in the now, you know. Our understanding of having been, you know, arises from this collapsing of present and past. All right, someone's asked a question. Am I supposed to be taking questions now, or is it just incidental? No, okay, I think someone's hand was up erroneously. Okay, I'm so sorry. All right, so you know, this folded structure of temporality that I was talking about, consciousness and how we understand and experience the present. And what is important, I think, to understand how we consume the media is, you know, also how we experience nowness and immediacy. Now, at this point, when we're talking about retentions and protentions, you know, memories and expectations, Bernard Stiegler, who is, of course, a media philosopher, recently passed away. Stiegler proposed a third, a tertiary retention. You know, Husserl only talked about a primary and a secondary. And Stiegler said there's actually an extra, there's a tertiary retention to extend and complete this model, which is that which comes into contact with the exteriority of technical objects, prosthetics, memory aids, right? Technological objects. And these, he said, you know, they carry traces of the past and they are thus constitutive of an externalized form of memory. So Stiegler asserted that, you know, we had to take into account that the constitution of this temporality that we experience is elaborated and conserved by these organic technical objects. So my entire take on media, this is the reason I explained this, took 5 minutes out to say this, is because I want us to think about how we consume media in time and how cultural memory, you know, tertiary retention through these technological memory aids, media forms, and, you know, the video forms that I'm about to talk about, this kind of tertiary retention, this kind of prosthetic or pneumata, is therefore, you know, it's culturally devised, not just technical, and it's necessarily political, of course, right? So having said that, you know, when we experience, say, film, right? Now, most of us understand that film is, you know, as Jean-Luc Godard said, 24 frames of truth per second, right? Most of us understand that film is a passage of time. But there is, as we track the transformation of media forms, there's a drastic difference that comes in how we consume or how our consciousness perceives temporality in media. And very often we tend to collapse film and television and new media and think that it's all the same, but of course it's not. And one of the ways in which I want to highlight this difference is through, you know, what is very often in film philosophy called the concept of suture. Now, when I watch a film, you know, and I mean a conventional piece of cinema, right? Shot, we know that in cinema, shots come after. These shots are stitched together. But what comes in between the gap, right? So Jacqueline Miller and other media theorists would say that, you know, the individual, the subject, there's a subject position that is sewn into the gaps. Therefore, they use the term suture, right? And that suture sort of situated us as consuming subjects in the passage of time of watching cinema. So you never felt disrupted. And what this also created, therefore, was a sense of continuity, right? When I'm watching a cinema, there's a sense of continuity. It's never disrupted. You have a narrating perspective, or I imagine, actually, as a subject, I imagine that there is a narrative perspective that sews together these shots. And I understand that there's a progress and I'm kind of sewn into that, right? But when you come to television, and here's one jump, right? So Sean Hubert, famous television theorist, in his work Time Shift, he would say that there's actually a loss of suture when you jump onto television because the subject is lost to televisual discourse. That's what he says. Because he says, you know, television discourse, conventional television, not what we're watching today, but conventional television, he said, it's not organized for continuity, but for discontinuity, right? There's editing between the program segments, there's ad breaks, there's announcers, newscasters, and this constant disruption and disconnection of the subject from this, that I can pause something here and say, I'm going to watch it another time. Or that I am, you know, just disconnected from it by life because my teacher caught me watching it under my, you know, desk in the classroom or whatever it is, right? And therefore the popularity of short form videos, GIFs, and such video content. And that's what's driving the mobile telecom boom that is shrinking the size of our screens today. And think also of, you know, films that are being created for handheld devices, right? About a couple of years ago, of course, Netflix tried, you know, a narrative control film with Black Mirror Bandersnatch, which was a film where you could select the narrative and its outcomes. Now, obviously, I mean, you can, if you have a smart TV, you can, of course, use your remote to select. But it goes without saying that it presumes that you're not watching it in the, because you can't have a film like that where the audience actively selects where the narrative is going. Should I choose this cereal box or that cereal box, this tape or that tape? You're telling the character what to do, and that supposedly changes the narrative outcome. But that again, you know, if you think about it, requires a kind of commitment. So I can't be completely distracted and control the narrative of a film. You know, 2 years ago when I was trying to watch it, I mean, I would sort of watch it in 20 minutes installments for like 3 or 4 nights in a row, because I just didn't have that kind of time. So time and the shortness of it and the smallness of my device, these are serious considerations in how video content is being made, right? Now, obviously, this leads us to, you know, the question, I mean, when you say social media, you're also, it's social, not just media, right? And we have to look at that aspect as well. So one, what we just talked about, you know, that temporality, time and lived realities of people are driving how content is being created. The second aspect other than the temporal is the social, you know. One of the key aspects of traditional TV viewing was that, of course, you sat in your home and you watched it collectively. You know, there was very little privacy, and, you know, for people who were young with televisions at home, it was a big sore point, right? You wanted to watch something like a love story, you wanted to watch it privately, but then your parents walk in, yeah, okay, I have to change the channel. This is not going to work out. But, you know, when you look at, when you looked at television, there's a sense of collectivity. And unexpectedly, I would say that collectivity also re-emerges on social media platforms, because everything's out there again, you know. On YouTube and WhatsApp, these platforms are also fostering a viewing community, I would say, which is acting out in, you know, the comment section on YouTube, also in sharing practices. So on particular WhatsApp groups, I'm sure all of us are members of, I mean, especially during the pandemic, it's like we have no control over how many WhatsApp groups we are a part of, every single subcommittee and everything in your department, you know, sort of turns into a WhatsApp group. And then, God forbid, it's not official, so people can share content on it. And then you can see, you know, depending on your different groups, how there are community practices, of course, in WhatsApp groups, right? If you live in a residential complex and there's a WhatsApp group for that, there are certain community practices being fostered there. If it's your department groups, there are certain community practices there, or in college groups, et cetera, et cetera. And we instinctively understand that. You know, like I for one, I know that all the politically problematic Hindutva posts are going to come on my apartment group, right? But never ever in my college group, because it's a liberal arts college, you know? So we instinctively understand how sharing practices and recommendations work, right? But the interesting thing is also that, you know, our tastes are being discretized. They're being turned into data, which is then stored, and trending topics and WhatsApp groups and subscriptions on YouTube. And of course, as we are increasingly beginning to understand, things that you text your best friend about in the middle of the night are going to come on Facebook as recommendations for you in the morning, because WhatsApp is listening to you, right? So you see, your deepest thoughts in the middle of the night are being discretized. They're being turned into data, and they're being turned into statistics. And even on YouTube, you know, people collectively, you know, there is annotation on videos. You can do it collectively even. And therefore, those add signification to the videos that you are looking at. And, you know, you can further share your interests on social networking. And the possibilities are now extending beyond, you know, just the interface of the screen to the real world. Because, you know, you have social media networking events. You have online meetings like this, you know, which are taking place in real time. Somebody could use this as an advertising platform and be sharing links to us in the comments box. And nobody would dare, I know, but they could, you know, possibly. Right? So, and these are providing those kind of situational possibilities. All right. So there's a collectivity. That's what I want to emphasize here. There is a sense of collective social practice that is emerging on these platforms. Now, the non-syndicated, that is not company-created, but individual-created content on social media, emerges from personal databases. You know, I take a video of my dog or my cat, and I think it's cute. And I edit it on Instagram or TikTok and I turn it into a reel and I put it out there. And then suddenly, you know, it's a story for other people to see. I also turned it into a narrative with my comments and the choice of music and the stickers and the cute things that I put on it. I suddenly made it a story, what was just a random video languishing about in my phone. So you see, that is individual driven content. And that's largely what we're consuming on social media. We're not forwarding so much of ads and things like that between us, right? We're largely forwarding individual creative content on social media. And these cater also to a certain need or a desire for access to those individual lives that is prompted by the community. You know, like you go somewhere, you do something and your friends tell you, Pixar, it didn't happen. I didn't see anything on it. You give a talk, I didn't see anything on Insta. You know, that's how people, you know, sort of behave these days, because there's a sense that if it isn't documented and discretized, it isn't out there. It didn't really take place, you know. So virtual time becomes real time, becomes virtual time. It's an endless cycle. And thus, social media's collection of clips also typically reflects a curating of what is, for its users, a sense of their own past and presence. And it begins to constitute a cultural memory over time, right? Especially during the pandemic. I mean, you look at social media videos during the pandemic, there are all these lockdown challenges and all sorts of things. And I feel like when we're going to look back at this pandemic, of course, we will remember the humdrum sense of being locked into your house all the time. We will remember that. And as in my case, being driven insane by my children. But, you know, also, we're going to remember the kind of media that we consume, the kind of media that came out. In the morning, I know your session was talking about news. And I think especially at the beginning of the pandemic, how much of news we consumed, because we almost felt like, you know, you had to track COVID-19 on a daily basis. And now I don't even want to know what's happening to COVID-19 on a daily basis, you know. So we stopped watching the news. But what I'm saying is, you know, it's constituting a cultural memory. This is how we're going to remember these moments within our communities over time. And this brings me to, you know, my final points on how the media constitutes this memory. How, as I said in the beginning, there's a kind of collective cultural memory that is being built up by these technological devices, by these memata, right? Now the media, and especially through how we consume social media, one of the important things that is happening, and this has been, you know, talked about by anyone from Derrida to Stiegler, you know, Derrida called it artifactuality, you know, that I take my performance or something that I'm doing right now and I turn it into a media piece. I'm artifactualizing what I did. It also, what it does, according to even Derrida, is that it creates an eventization. You know, so the media, it produces time, right? And in a minute, I'm going to talk about how that time factors into our consciousness. But first, let me say the media produces time. I very often look at the length of a clip or I look at the length of a video, you know. And so, and I realized that there is, even if it's a, why do I prefer a 2-minute clip? Because I can commit to 2 minutes, right? So the media produces time and it also actively affects what we perceive as event in memory, right? Like I said, the example that I used just now, you know, that if it wasn't on social media, it didn't happen, right? So social media eventizes, even things that are not, would not seem like events, are mundane, right? And it turns them into memories. And it also works to store and restore this, all right? So, you know, it keeps it there for you, it archives it. And there's not only a selection and a delineation of what is event, but also a predetermination of what will be event. I mean, what I'm saying is that the media is also sort of, especially social media use, and this has been said a lot, you know, is also dictating how our behaviors are. So I'm going to do something that I think would make a cute video, you know, or, you know, somehow I can't take out my baking goods into the kitchen without feeling. What I have been referencing Stiegler a lot throughout the talk. And what Stiegler says is, you know, one thing is, and you can see right at the middle of This is a quote from Stiegler. He says the desire for stories, that's what he calls, the seduction of, they can enable you to have that desire constantly being supplied. Of course, then he will argue, but like Adorno says, it's never completed. Your desire is never fulfilled by the media. It only kind of half plugs the need, right? The other thing that Stiegler says is, that the kind of newness and instantaneity of the way the program industry works through the internet, etc., it also disorientates and deterritorializes the digital media that people are consuming. I think this is so important for what Dr. Thomas said in the intro, misinformation, right? Why do we live in the era of misinformation? Because there is no authentication of sources with social media videos, right? I don't know where it came from. I don't know when it came from. My phone doesn't give me the technology to track it. So I have to go to a, fake or not kind of website to figure out whether it's real or it's inauthentic or whatever it is, right? So there is a disorientation. Somebody can claim something is something that, and you can think of a million political examples in the kind of videos that we consume, where things that are not are made out to seem which they are, and deterritorializing as well. You could take a video from Shanghai and say it's Ahmedabad, and I'll believe you because I don't know. I just saw it on WhatsApp, right? And there's also that unquestioning kind of consumption that you'll believe anything on WhatsApp University, as we call it these days, right? So, these programming devices, these memory aids that we're talking about, the videos and the platforms that broadcast them, they're all creating this database. And what Stiegler says is, his intervention here is, he says, the problem is they both fix as well as stifle your desire. So I want these stories and I think I know what I want. So I'm constantly going to social media looking for that. But at the same time, there's a kind of confinement, isn't it? Now, when you go to YouTube, all that hyperlinking and, YouTube seems like an infinite sort of, platform. And I feel like I can while away the entire of my life there, but it's not actually infinite. And in fact, what we talked about before, hyperlinking, the discretization of our tastes and our community's tastes are actually driving what we see. And I think we all instinctively understand that we don't have free choice on YouTube. The recommendations are being dictated to us. And the same with WhatsApp. We don't just get to see all the videos that are out there on the world. The same with Instagram, right? Whatever is trending is playing, on my phone. And therefore, it both satisfies that desire for stories that I need. But also fixes it. It's also controlling it. And therefore, my desires are being stifled. Another way in which my desires are being stifled are, that they're also creating a fiction of their own. Okay, so social media can endlessly supply and supplement my desire for stories because they're constantly making available these individual temporal objects, these little videos, these GIFs and stuff like that, which can satisfy my cinematic desire, for fiction. But also at the same time, and this is something I feel like we need to work on and think about, is how they're creating a fiction of their own, how, our sharing practices create a narrative of their own. They create a narrative, especially of, like I said, what is event and what society is going through, what are society's crises. I mean, if you were to reconstitute social history through videos shared on social media, you'd get a very skewed perception. But ironically, that is what we're consuming. That is what we sort of take in every day, right? So my last point in this talk, and I really wanted to sort of keep it brief and punchy, is also that, since we started talking about time, what these, media pieces, these short videos, what they're also doing is controlling our individuation, that is the development of our consciousness into an individual subjecthood. We've already looked at how they do that through controlling our desire. And the coming together of individual desires takes place in this kind of industry via a hypersynchronization of time and consciousness. And this is especially relevant when we are watching, say, live events together, right? Or live media on the internet. There's a hypersynchronization of the times, the temporal worlds of so many millions of people and the consciousness of so many people. When the spectatorial consciousness is adopting the time of programs, right? Right at the beginning of my talk, I talked about how Husserl says, you know, time passes in a melody. And as, you know, you experience the melody, your time is also passing. You know, you plot the time of your consciousness onto a melody. And this is the same for audiovisual consumption, right? I plot the time of my consciousness in that commitment that I make. I plot the time. I am passing the time of my consciousness along with the time of the program. So I'm basically adopting the time of the program, right? And it is this seduction, this hypersynchronization that ultimately leads to the destruction of the self. Why? Why is it destructing myself? Because on one hand, it appeals to me because, or it's an illusory appeal actually, because it tells me that it's appealing to me as an individual. You know, I think I'm controlling my choices on YouTube or WhatsApp or whatever it is. I think that, you know, when I pick up my phone, I feel like it's my personal device, and therefore its content is very personal, right? But of course, your content is never personal; it's political. No need to cite the cases of, you know, recent intellectuals all over India who have been arrested based on the content in the hard drives of their computers. I mean, God knows what's lounging in the hard drive of my computer. I have no control over who sent me what and when I downloaded it into my drive. All right. But I always think of my device as personal, don't I? I think of WhatsApp as a personal thing. I think of my social media pages also as somehow personal. But the illusion here is that it's never personal. And the autonomous individual consumer, you know, that, say, Adorno spoke of, doesn't exist anymore. There is actually no individual desire out there. Or if there is, we need to save it, right? We've become, I mean, it's become a mythical figure, that individual consumer of media, you know, an individual consuming subject. It's something of a unicorn now. Because, you know, what the program industry does is that the collective, you know, the community that I've been speaking of, you know, this the shared practices that create this kind of community around me, it's creating a co-constitution of consciousness together. And in the program industry, we are being condensed into this kind of globalized, impersonal one. This is what even Stiegler suggests, right? So you can, I mean, you can always switch off, right? I mean, when people say, oh no, what can we do then, right? I mean, it's so simple. It's a choice that we make. We can switch on or switch off. I think if we participate in social media, then of course we have to make ethical choices. You know, we cannot imagine that we are unconscious users. We cannot also imagine that social media spaces are highly personal, right? We have to think of them as what they are, social and political spaces. And therefore we have to consciously consume and try as much as we, and what we're sharing, also very importantly, because at the end of the day, what we're doing is sort of, you know, we are sort of creating an archive, and this is the way that we will be remembered, and this is the way that our communities and our spaces will be remembered for all time. All right, so this is, of course, the bulk of my talk. Let me just put off my presentation, and of course, I hope that we can sort of, you know, develop more in some very interesting questions.
Thank you, Susan George, ma'am, for that talk about social media, because this is something that connects very well to the current generation of people, because we use a lot of social media for the, you know, the purpose of a kind of, you know, self-actualization, or, you know, our need for human connection, and even in tapping the, you know, creative potential of the people. And I also think that it also provides you with a screen behind which you could hide, and perhaps even hide your self and even project cells that would otherwise remain hidden. It's a very complicated and multifaceted space that is offered by the social media. But we have a few questions, I think, here. There is Sam Johnson who asks, there are many who haven't yet placed or weren't able to place themselves into these spaces. Where do you locate them in this study?
Yeah, it's a wonderful question. And I was hoping actually that this would be one of the questions that came up, you know, because when you talk about social media, you have to say that, you know, especially in India, I feel that it's still tied at some level to privilege, although there is this extreme democratization that we see around us. You know, everyone who has a mobile device of some kind is at some level plugged in and consuming, though not everyone. So yes, you know, I would say that probably, you know, that those who aren't placed in these spaces, you know, there is still, you know, so there is, their desires aren't that controlled, or they don't exist in those kind of fictional stories. And they're not, you know, part of those narratives. Interesting, because actually someone was talking to me about the new movie called Home, you know, with Indians in it, that is showing on Amazon Prime, which apparently addresses exactly this question. You know, about an older member of a family who's not, you know, sort of plugged into the internet. I haven't seen it, but I'm dying to, you know, and how he sort of feels left out of this. But I want to say that I feel like, you know, since there is this huge alternative, like you said, Rahul, it's an alternative space where we are versions of ourselves, and it's one great stage for a lot of people to participate in. And I do feel that there's this growing sense of a need to participate. It's also seen as it's a desirable space to be. Those who are outside of it, I mean, no, we can't place value judgments on, you know, that, because it could be somebody in extreme privilege who does not want to be in that space, or somebody who just, you know, isn't a part of it by default, you know. But gradually, I feel that we will not be able to resist these anymore. Right? There's still a choice, or there's still people left out of it. But I feel like over a period of time, we will be subsumed by it. I don't know. I'm a cynic. So that's my perspective on this. It's just a matter of time, I feel.
People just ask them by unmuting themselves. Do you think that in social media there also exists a gender and a class divide, because we see a lot of misogyny in the social media, as well as when people create content, like for example on TikTok or on Instagram, certain classes of people are constantly abused. What do you think about that?
I think it's a reflection of society, isn't it? Because, you know, like we said, it's a cultural memory. You look at television at a certain period in time, and it reflects exactly those kind of cultural attitudes as, you know, those communities define them. And social media, except that, I mean, I feel, and this is something I didn't say, there's also a huge volume overload of information on social media. You know, where in television or with cinema, the volumes are control. You don't feel like you can consume too much. But with social media, there is hyper consumption. So definitely the ills of society appear to be, you know, more emphasized. And I think it's a question of volume, to me. I feel like we need to rationalize it against the amount of content that is constantly being created. As you so very rightly pointed out when you were, commenting after my talk, it's also a creative space. You know, so it allows, now anybody can make a video. It's democratized completely, right? So that kind of flood of content, I think we need to rationalize
accounts, but not so vigorously active, but they do consume content. Here and now they would comment and respond, but not that active. In comparison with the kind of YouTube videos that happen whenever a smartphone is released, video bloggers only focus on those who are gamers and those who don't use smartphones in that way very actively, but the person or the individual who is in between.
Yeah, I think I understood your question. It's an interesting perspective, ma'am. I mean, because you look around you and, just in the same way that social media creates communities, it also invisibilizes people. And I think that's what you mean. You don't feel hailed in the Althusserian sense of culture speaking to you or hailing you. You don't feel hailed by social media when you're not an active participant in it. So very often, that's why I think social media is so... has such a deep imprint on, subjecthood and, formation, because very often people seek, they seek to be hailed, they seek to be addressed, that it becomes more inclusive. But, the example that you gave, which is fascinating, I would never have thought of that, unboxing videos and phone, tech videos, which always, touch upon a certain tech consumption community, those completely invisibilized users, like you said, who are not, that in tune into technology and just want to
committed faculty. I would like to thank my teachers for taking time away from the schedule to make students attend this thought-provoking session. On behalf of Department of English, Marthoma College, I would like to extend a very hearty thanks to eminent speaker, Dr. Susan George, Assistant Professor, Department of English, Jesus and Mary College. Memories make me who I am, or how WhatsApp and YouTube programmed my design. Thank you, ma'am, for your thought-provoking session you have shared with us today. I extend a hearty thanks to dear head of the department, Ashley Miss, for her support and confidence in us. And I thank the moderator for session, Professor Rahul N, and all other teachers for their guidance. Thank you, dear teachers. I extend my sincere gratitude to the coordinator, Professor Anne Marie Raju, and student conveners Alex Johnson and Jinsley Elizabeth for their timely efforts to make this event happen. I would like to thank everyone who helped our committee make this international virtual conference through the looking glass, making lives and realities and pandemic times a reality. Thank you, dear participants and presenters, for taking time to be here today. Thank you and have a great day.
Hello everyone, just a short announcement. This announcement is regarding the paper presentations. Paper presentations will take place in parallel sessions. Three parallel paper presentation sessions will begin shortly after the announcement. Links for the same have been provided for the presenters in the paper presentation list and in the respective WhatsApp groups. Presenters for paper presentation 2A should remain in this meeting. Presenters for groups 2B and 2C should join the respective sessions once the announcement is over. Others who would like to attend the presentation may also stay back. The session's feedback form for certificates is provided in the chat box. Please note that tomorrow we'll be having our third session at 9 a.m. Dr. Darshana Sridhar Mini will deliver a talk on techno-modernity and mobile intimacy in Malayalam cinema. Participants are requested to join by 8:50 a.m. Thank you.